this is it. This is one of the big ticket items here in Ireland. This is one of the big tourist attractions. In fact, the most visited, most popular tourist attraction in all of Ireland. This, in fact, those are the Cliffs of Moher. Moher. Saying it right? The Cliffs of Moher.
Very tempting to say.
They're pretty
right.
Spectacular. Yeah. Let's hit you up with some cliff facts. Claire. Yeah.
They were formed 320 million years ago during the Upper Carboniferous period.
Carboniferous?
I can't say I've ever heard of that.
I don't know, good word. Well pronounced.
Carboniferous.
They run for about 5 miles along the coast of County Clare, which is where we are now, County Clare. and the highest point, I think, is 702 feet above sea level, which
214 meters.
Someone's very good with their metric. Just north of here, actually, there is the highest point. We're at the visitor experience at the moment, and it's really quiet. Actually, we're here quite nice and early. The sun's just shining, just come out.
It's like
4 degrees, but the views are spectacular. We got, like I said, we've got the cliffs just behind us here, and if I turn this way, you have the Aran Islands over there. So Inishir, Inishman and Inishmore. Another little fun fact about the Cliffs of Moher. Before the visitor centre opened here, you used to be able to come and lie on your belly on this rock here, hang your head over the end and look directly down 200 metres to the sea and the shore below you. Can't do it anymore, obviously, for safety reasons, but I imagine it would have been quite a spectacular thing to do in the past. So Claire, what did you think of Ireland's most visited tourist attraction?
It's all right.
It's good. They are spectacular cliffs. Admittedly, they're not the most spectacular ones we've seen on our entire trip. But
they're just taller.
They are very tall, tall sea cliffs. It attracted 1.5 million visitors last year, so by far Ireland's most popular tourist attraction. And you should definitely come and see it. It's worth the while.
It's one to tick off the list.
It is. If you're doing the Wild Atlantic Way, we're just past the halfway point here, so it makes a good sort of celebration of your journey down the road.
Yeah, we've come all the way from Muff.
We have, all the way from Muff, and we're going all the way down to Cork.
Yes.
So Muff to Cork, this is about halfway. Come and see it. We're here. In fact, we stayed overnight at a very unique place last night and today. Where is that, Claire?
It is the Foynes Flying Boat Museum. By the way, thank you, Britstop. It's one of the better ones.
Amazing. What an amazing, unique location this. The world's only flying boat museum. And if you don't know what a flying boat is, stick with us because we're going to show you and tell you all about it.
And this one's going to get very excited.
More than likely, yes.
Took a monkey for a ride in the air. The monkey thought that everything was on the square. The buzzer tried to throw the monkey off his back, The monkey grabbed his neck and said, "Now listen, Jack. Straighten up and fly right. Straighten up and fly right. Straighten up and fly right. Cool down, Papa, don't you blow your top. Ain't no use in diving. What's the use of jiving? Straighten up and fly right. Cool down, Papa, don't you blow your top." The buzzer told the monkey, "You are choking me. Release your hold and I will set you free." The monkey looked the buzzer right dead in the eye and said, "Your story is so touching, but it sounds just like a lie. Straighten up and fly right. Straighten up and stay right. Straighten up and fly right. Cool down, Papa, don't you blow your top." Stay right. Straighten up and fly right. Cool down, Papa, don't you blow your top. Fly right.
Now here at the Flying Boat Museum at Foynes, they have this amazing reproduction behind us. This is actually a 100% scale replica of a Boeing B314 flying boat. Now, I know the term flying boat has probably confused a few people, because it confused me when I first heard it. These are basically the predecessors to today's things like 747s and stuff like that. These are what people used to fly across the Atlantic on before the Second World War, before the jet engines. Yeah. And they used to fly literally and land on water, hence the name flying boats.
And they were piloted effectively like a boat.
The flying boats is where a lot of the terminology comes from for modern aviation today. So things like captain and stuff like that, because it was a flying boat, the crew on board had to be both aviators and seafarers.
Navigators.
They navigated. There was no, you know, fancy computer equipment to navigate across the Atlantic.
They used sextants
and the moon and the stars and the sun and things like that to navigate across the Atlantic.
Terrifying.
Incredible. So these things didn't fly for very long. So the Boeing 314 was probably the latest development of the flying boat.
It was the largest, wasn't it?
It was the largest. Flew for both Pan American Airways, which this one is painted up in the livery of. There's the PAA logo. And also Imperial Airways, which is the predecessor to today's British Airways.
Yes. Well, they worked together, didn't they?
They did. Yeah. They signed a memorandum to say that together they would conquer the Atlantic for passenger traffic. It was a big thing to connect Europe and America. And to think now we can do it in 8 hours on a jet plane in relative comfort. For example, these things only flew at 11,000 feet. Most commercial airlines nowadays fly at 39,000 feet, so above the weather. These had a top sort of cruising speed of 118 miles an hour, which is like nothing, which is like most cars can do that. Most airliners nowadays fly at about 500 miles an hour. So it would take quite a while to get across the Atlantic, and it would be not the most comfortable voyage on one of these.
Or quiet.
Or
with those engines.
Or quiet, indeed. As an example of how long it would take, the flying boat, so it would be a once-a-week service going to America. The flying boat would leave Southampton at 2 o'clock in the afternoon on a Wednesday, fly here to Foynes, stop for an hour to refuel, and then take off again, landing twice in Canada, and then finally arriving into Port Washington, New York at 2 o'clock the next day.
So it would take, not really 24 hours, but it would take that amount of time, because it landed at 2 o'clock US time, that amount of time to transverse the Atlantic in what now takes 7-8 hours. And in fact, if you think back to Concorde, it used to take, what, 3-4 hours?
Yeah.
You know, you could be in, you could leave London before lunch, and you could have, was it breakfast in London and lunch in New York? It was that fast, it really
was. I think
it was breakfast in London, breakfast in New York. Have breakfast twice. So, now, we said it wasn't a particularly comfortable experience on board, but actually, both Pan Am and BOAC, as they became to know after they were Imperial Airways, did what they could to make the flying boat super comfortable.
Mm.
And thankfully, here at Foynes, you can get on board this. So they've actually refitted it out as an interior. So let's go on board and take a look. So here we are on board Foynes Flying Boat Museum replica of the Boeing B314 flying boat, and they've done a really amazing job with it, to be honest with you. We're here in the very front cabin, which you can see is the seating looks relatively comfortable. You know, they've tried to recreate it in as good a way as they can. If we have a look through here, you can see into the nose of the flying boat, and in there would have been various elements, including the anchor. Obviously, these boats had had to anchor at sea or at port like a boat would. So it's a weird kind of mashup of an aircraft and a boat, hence the flying boat. So we'll move backwards now down the flying boat, and we'll point out a few interesting things along the way. So here is the galley. So this was where all the amazing meals were prepared and made for all the passengers on board both Pan Am and Imperial Airways flights. And they were treated to wonderful things. You know, it wasn't just airline food as we know it. It was, you know, fancy meals and roast beefs and alcohol and cocktails and cigars and all those kind of things. We'll keep heading back this way. Lavatory is as much as it needs to be said, to be honest with you. Although, compare that to the size of a plain bathroom that you've been on, and you can see, actually, it's massive. So as we move backwards, so this section we're in now is more the sort of economy, although there was never really an economy section on these kind of things because it was so expensive to fly on them.
It was $314 for a one-way ticket.
Which in today's money is many, many thousands of dollars, I would imagine. But as you can see, it was comfy, it was well spaced, you had you know, a little bit of your own sort of space compared to modern airlines now.
I mean, look at the size of these seats. Could almost fit two of me in that.
Massive, aren't they?
And the leg room too, the leg room.
Now as we continue down, here we're into a room that's been set out like a dining suite. So this is where food would have been served, and again, comfortable chairs, all those kind of things, and it was proper silver service in the sky. You know, the stewards and the stewardesses were trained in the full silver service. Everything was presented immaculately, as much as it could be at 11,000 feet rattling around on a flying boat.
We end up going uphill, obviously.
Yeah, we're now going up into the tail section of the flying boat, so we're walking up the rear of the flying boat itself. And here you can see how a sleeping berth would have been made up from the standard seating. So although the aircraft could carry 74 passengers in a daytime configuration, at night it was only suitable for 36, because you've got to think that's just one person. But the seats would form into beds, and then they would continue flying through the night. I can't imagine it was a very comfortable experience.
I think in the film we watched, they said they stuck cotton wool in their ears.
Yeah, it's gonna be very noisy. Modern jets now very quiet. This had got 900 horsepower propeller engines on each wing,
and
it would be seriously noisy. To the sort of rear sort of I guess the ladies' parlour.
Yes.
So this would have been the makeup, you know, room where women could beautify themselves and powder their noses and things like that, as they did back in those days.
Would have been an area for gossiping,
I'm sure.
I'm sure, because the men would not have been allowed in this bit.
Yes, indeed. And then you've got another small bathroom here.
that you can't really see because of light. There we go, there's the toilet. See? Magic toilet.
And then, as mentioned on the drawing that we saw outside, this is the suite. So the very VIP-est of VIP guests would get this private suite to themselves, positioned in the tail of the aircraft.
It looks like something raunchy's happened in there.
Certainly does. Now, it was positioned in the tail of the aircraft mainly because it was the quietest part of the aircraft. You were quite a long way back from the engines here, and it was the least likely to be thrown around in turbulence, which was quite a common occurrence on these flying boats of the era. It's quite a thing to see this. It really is. And when you think about the fact that these are the precursors to today's modern, clean, comfortable, quiet jet engines and jet airliners, it really is a thing. In fact, these things were so big, they needed such a big run-up to take off. If you can imagine basically lifting a boat out of the air with its wings. In fact, let's take a look at where they used to fly. In fact, where the runway used to be. It was
right here. Now excuse the sunglasses because it's quite sunny today and the noise of the ferry, but yeah, this is the Strait of Water here where the flying boats would have arrived and departed for their trip across the Atlantic. So now what is a relatively smooth, relatively empty part of water back in its heyday would have been the busiest, possibly the busiest airport in the world, with the flying boats coming in and out across the Atlantic and from all over the world. The full-scale replica of the Boeing 314 flying boat they have here at Foynes has been positioned in quite a way. As you can see, they've put it in its own little pool of water, so it looks like it's floating, and it is a full-scale replica, as you can see. Now, they've named it Yankee Clipper, which is quite apt, because this was the first flying boat to ever do the non-stop flight across the Atlantic. It's quite something, isn't it? It's quite something. And you had a fact about this flying boat?
Yeah. This was the Yankee Clipper, so not this one, because it's a reproduction, but the Yankee Clipper original was the third Clipper to be built. So the Honolulu Clipper was the first, and then it was the California Clipper. This one actually crashed in 1943.
Oh.
So I don't know any more details.
Oh, okay. But they called it Yankee Clipper because this was the first flying boat to arrive in Foynes after doing the non-stop flight across the Atlantic. Quite an achievement.
Now, here's another little fascinating fact about Foynes and this building in particular. So in 1942, 1943, they're not entirely sure, the head chef of the airport here at Foynes, a guy called Joe Sheridan, he was the head chef at the refreshment room that passengers would use when they were getting off the train and waiting for their flying boat, or getting off the flying boat as it's being refueled. He created the original Irish coffee, so coffee with sugar, with cream, with a shot of Irish whiskey in it, in this very building. And Foynes is essentially the home of Irish coffee. In here, as it says, B. O'Regan's, which is what the coffee shop is still called here, there is a hologram presentation that will teach you the story of how Joe came up with an Irish coffee in particular. So if you're here, check this out. Irish coffee was invented right here in Foynes.
Straighten up and fly right. Straighten up and stay right. Straighten up and fly right. Cool down, Papa, don't you blow your top. Thank you.
really fascinating thing we've learned about here at Foynes actually is the collection of the amazing woman
Maureen O'Hara.
Behind us. Yeah, Maureen O'Hara. Now, Maureen was a Hollywood actress from the golden age of cinema, so the 40s and 50s and you know,
right into the 60s and 70s, I think.
Starred alongside people like Jimmy Stewart, John Wayne, an amazing woman born here in Ireland. Her connection to Foynes is that she was married to Charles Blair, who was a flying boat captain for Pan American Airways and flew flying boats in and out of here through 1942, 1943, things like that. So she had a real connection to flying boats and a love for aviation.
So much so that she actually opened this museum in 1989.
Yeah.
And celebrated her birthday every year here.
Quite a thing, isn't
it? I believe until she passed away in 2015.
So she was born in 1920 and passed away in 2015 and saw more change in the world than any of us can probably ever imagine.
Yeah.
And it's quite a thing to have a Hollywood actress come here every year for her birthday, be a patron to this museum, and have such a love and passion for flying boats,
yeah.
And for Foynes as a place.
Her grandson has actually donated all of her belongings to the museum. So what we've seen here is only a small collection. We were told by the lady down on reception that the museum is actually expanding and building more onto the museum.
Wow.
Just so it can house a full collection and a real tribute to Maureen O'Hara.
So yeah, there you go. Incredible connection to Hollywood here in Foynes. Maureen O'Hara, the famous Hollywood actress, patron of this museum, and celebrating her birthday here every single year up until the year she died. Quite amazing. So that was the Foynes Flying Boat Museum, the only flying boat museum in the entire world. What do you think of it, Claire?
It was very, very good, actually.
I thought it was amazing. It
wasn't too geeky.
As you can tell, I got very excited. It was too geeky. Well, I was too geeky, but the museum's not geeky. So, like I said, if you love history or anything like that, come and pay a visit. It's just on the Wild Atlantic Way. You will love it, and you'll get to see this beauty as well, right here. The full-scale replica of a Boeing 314 Clipper flying boat. It's amazing.
We'll definitely be back when they've done the expansion to the museum.
Yes,
well.
Yeah, apparently they're expanding the museum, so we're definitely going to come back and pay another visit at some point in the future.
Yep.
Straighten up and fly right. Straighten up and stay right. Straighten up and fly right. Cool down, Papa, don't you blow your top. Fly right.